Hello, AP Physics students. We're going to make our way through this lecture on Newton's law of universal gravitation. Newton, when he finished the three laws of motion, still noticed that there were some predictable things about the motion of objects that were moving through the air on Earth as well as through the heavens. And so he concluded that the same force that was causing an apple to fall into his lap in that proverbial story we hear about him, that was the same force that was causing the moon to move in its orbit as well. So this is a little bit about, you know, how he kind of came up with those ideas. So Newton's law of gravity states that an object's force from a gravitational field is equal to the gravitational force constant, capital G, multiplied by the mass of the two objects that are interacting, that is divided by the distance between the center of mass of each of those two objects squared. So for the weight of an object, we would be thinking about M1 perhaps being you and your mass, and M2 being the mass of the Earth, and the distance between you and the center of the Earth would be R. So that would be how we would determine your weight using this more complicated version of the force due to gravity calculation. This is really the universal version of force due to gravity, however. So I've just kind of talked through this list right here and describe these things. Notice that the gravitation constant is extremely small. It's 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11th. So that's a really, really tiny number. That's why whenever you are holding a pencil in your hand, according to this law, there's a gravitational force between you and the pencil and between the pencil and you. But because that gravitational force constant is so tiny, that gravitational force between you and that pencil is imperceptible to you. However, mathematically, it's definitely there. From this formula, you can tell that gravitational force is directly proportional to the product of the masses. So as the masses increase, the force increases. And gravitational force is inversely proportional to the square of the distance between the center of mass of the two objects. So as the distance between the objects increases, the force will decrease at a faster rate. So for example, if the radial distance between two objects doubles, then the force will decrease by a factor of 4. And if the radial distance between two objects increases by a factor of 3, then the force will decrease by a factor of 9. So that's mathematically accurate, since if we double the radius, then 2 squared is 4, so that makes the force 4 times smaller. Or if we triple the radius, 3 to the second power is 9, so that means the force due to gravity will decrease by a factor of 9. Just one more word about that. That's a really important kind of thought process to keep in mind, because there's tons and tons of AP questions that will be related to that sort of idea, whether or not you can determine what the effect will be on the force if any one of these values changes, given that the uppercase G will never change. Okay, so now this is an inverse square law. So in mathematics, you've seen inverse square laws as well. And it's an inverse square law since the denominator is a squared term. As I kind of talked about before, as the distance in this case doubles, the gravitational force would increase by a factor of 4. If the distance were to triple, the gravitational force will increase by a factor of 3 squared or 9. If the distance increases by a factor of 5, then the gravitational force would decrease by a factor of 5 squared or 25. Okay. Remember, the gravitational force of one object on of object one onto object two is equal in magnitude and opposite in direction to the gravitational force on object two by object one. So that's kind of that is definitely a restatement of Newton's third law, that for every action there's an equal and opposite reaction, and the force types are the same. So the third law action reaction force to your weight, your weight is your pull toward the Earth. This third law reaction force to that is the Earth, is your pull on the Earth, because you have a gravitational field and you are pulling on the Earth as well. Okay, let's talk a bit more about that. So the universal gravitation equation is listed right here, and it works every place. So that is accurate everywhere. So whether you're in the International Space Station, on Mars, you could determine the force due to gravity between yourself and whatever distant mass you might be paying attention to, and determine that force. You know, for example, on the space station, there could be multiple forces. There could be a force due to gravity on the space station and the occupants of it by the Earth. There could also be a force due to gravity, and is a force due to gravity, on the space station by the Moon. And so the Moon's mass could go in here. So that's part of the reason for things like the wobble of the Earth's rotation around the Sun, because there's more than one force acting on the Earth. The Earth certainly has a huge force exerted on it by the Sun because of the Sun's extremely large mass, but there are some other forces acting on the Earth as well from other less massive objects in the universe, and that gives the Earth just a strange little wobble, so that what appears to be a perfectly elliptical and nearly circular path around the Sun actually is kind of a tiny little spiraling motion along that circular path. Okay, I kind of got off the track here, so sorry. The FG equals M, the FG equals capital G times N1 N2 over R squared. That works every place. It doesn't matter. But the weight formula for, you know, W or F sub G equals M times G only works when you're close to the Earth's surface, because that particular value of G on the Earth right here is 9.81 meters per second squared. So let's kind of look at how that works. So how does this gravitational field strength formula relate to the weight formula? Well, here each of the formulas listed up above, they're both true. However, let's notice that the yellow M's, let's assume that's your mass. So in that case, if we were to set these two equal to each other, then each of these yellow masses, that's your mass, so that can cancel out. So when we rearrange it or flip it around, then that means that the force of gravity on you, or the acceleration of gravity on you, is the gravitational field constant times the mass of the Earth divided by the radius of the Earth, since you are on the surface of the Earth, radius of the Earth squared, pardon me. So that means on Earth, there's a fairly consistent 9.81 meters per second acceleration toward the center of the Earth that causes this that is the result of the gravitational field. On the Moon, that this formula would be slightly different, because we would put in the mass of the Moon, and we would substitute here the radius of the Moon, and in completing that calculation, you would find that the gravitational acceleration on the Moon's surface is about 1.6 meters per second per second. Similarly, if you did this for Jupiter is extremely massive, and it's also has a really large radius. And I believe, if memory serves me correctly, I believe that the gravitational field strength on Jupiter is about 23 meters per second per second. So if you and I were to go try to stand on Jupiter, we wouldn't be able to. Our bones would, and our tendons would stretch and squish, and we'd just be, we wouldn't be able to walk upright, that's for sure. And it would probably, over time, crush serve to crush your sternum and bad things would happen. But anyhow, the whole goal of this is for you to see that this value of G right here in this handy equation we use for weight on the surface of the Earth is simply a chunk of the universal gravitation formula. They're not different. They're the same thing. We just recognize that these values are always going to be the same on the surface of the Earth. So instead of having to do this long formula every time, we're able to use this to extract the value for all of the forces, all of the elements that affect gravitational field strength, and then we can do a simple calculation to determine weight on the Earth's surface. Okay, so here's an example. If the mass of the Earth is about 6 times 10 to the 24th kilograms, and the mass of the Moon is 7.4-ish, 10 to the 22 kilograms, and the distance is about 3.84 times 10 to the 8 meters, how much force does the Earth exert on the Moon? And remember that the gravitational field strength, the gravitational constant is 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11th. Keep in mind that this distance between them needs to be distance between their centers of mass. Okay, the Earth at its apogee is about 4 times 10 to the 8th meters from the Earth, and then the Moon at its perigee is about 3.6. So this assumes kind of an average of that, and included in this needs to be the radial distance from the Moon and the Earth's centers to their surface. However, that's relatively small in this case compared to that long distance, but you do need to remember that it's from center of mass to center of mass, not surface to surface. Okay, so here's our formula, and we know what each mass is, given the information above. We know what the universal gravitation constant is, and we are provided the radial distance between their centers of mass. So it's just a quick calculation. One of the things I suggest when you do these is that you pull out all of the exponential terms and handle those separately from the values listed. So in this problem, I would do 6.67 times 7.36 times 5.97 and divide that by 3.84 twice, since this is squared. And I would get some number. I'd write that down. And then I would mathematically combine 10 to the negative 11th to 10 to the 22 to 10 to the 24th so that I would know what my exponent would be to the 10th and then apply that. That's pretty simple. It's a heck of a lot easier than trying to stick that into your calculator. Okay, so our final answer here becomes about 2 times 10 to the 20th newtons. So that's not much force. You know, the Earth is only exerting, you know, is not exerting a ton of force on the Moon at its distance, but it's enough to keep the Moon in its orbit. So that Fg here is actually the centripetal force on the Moon from the Earth's gravitational field. Okay, here's Saturn. So Saturn has a mass that is larger than Earth's. It's larger by a factor of 10 to the 2, because this is 10 to the 26th. And its radius is also larger. So we're trying to figure out what G is on Earth. So by doing this calculation, we can determine that the gravitational field strength on Saturn is about 11.1 meters per second squared. Okay, so you might want to stop this one and work it out. A 50 kilogram person orbiting the Earth in a satellite at a distance of 9,370,000 meters from Earth's center, what would that person's weight be? This is really important that they gave you this distance from the Earth's center, all right? If it gave you height above the Earth, then you would have to add that the radial radius of the Earth. So this is distance from Earth's center. So it includes not only the 50 kilogram person's height, above the Earth's surface, but also the radial distance from the surface of the Earth to the Earth's center. So that's good. So stop this and try working this out real quick, and then come back and see if you were right. Did you stop it, or are you waiting? Stop it and work the problem. Okay, so hopefully you did stop it and work the problem, and you got about 226.8 newtons. All right, so let's think a little bit about orbiting satellites. When objects move in a circular path, they move in a circular path because there's a force that is perpendicular to their motion that keeps them moving in a circular path. The centripetal force is always perpendicular to the object's path. So whenever a satellite orbits a planet or star, it's the gravitational force that's causing that uniform circular motion of the satellite. We're going to go ahead and treat the motion of satellites and the orbit of planets as though it's uniform circular motion, although in actuality, in most cases, the orbits are elliptical. However, they're not very eccentric ellipses. You know that eccentricity of an ellipse means how far the centers are from one another. So when an ellipse has a low eccentricity, then it's more circle-like. If it has a high eccentricity, then it's more like a stretched out oval shape. So we're dealing with circles that or potentially ellipses that are so close to being circles that we can treat them as circles. Sorry, I'm kind of getting off track. So what do we call the force that causes uniform circular motion? Well, it's a centripetal force, and in this case, it's usually Fg. So we're going to go through and look at this. We're going to pay attention to the two of these formulas we particularly like. The force due to gravity is the gravitational constant times the mass of one object times the mass of the second object divided by the radial distance between their center of masses squared. So that's the force due to gravity. Then centripetal force is always the mass of the object times the velocity of the object squared over the radius of that object in its path. And notice that M1 is the smaller object. That's the object we really pay attention to. And M2 is like the planet or the object that keeps it in its circular path. So if we're talking about the FC vector, we always want to put in the mass of the rotating object here. This would never be the mass of the planet. This is the mass of the thing that's moving around the other object. So if we set these two equal to each other, then M1 cancels out immediately. And then we can cancel out 1r on each side. So we end up with v squared is equal to g times m2 divided by r. And then take the square root of that. And we find out that the velocity of an object that's moving in a circular path due to a gravitational field keeping it in that circular path, that object's velocity is the square root of the gravitational force constant times the mass of the planet divided by the radial distance. That's a really important equation right there. And we just derived it because of what we knew about centripetal forces and the gravitational force constant. But we're going to use that equation in just a second. All right, so make sure you've got that written down and you understand that derivation. Okay, so here we have a satellite that's orbiting Earth, and the distance between them is 9,370,000 meters. What's the speed of the satellite? So we're actually solving directly for that Vt value. So we're just going to use the V equals square root of G times M over R. You could do it by going back and setting it up from this perspective, because really this is what you're doing. You're doing this whole derivation right here. So keep that in mind, that this is actually what you're doing. But we've done all that work so that now we can just go straight to using the v equals the square root of that expression. So we get a velocity of about 6,000 meters per second. That's pretty substantial velocity. All right, so let's talk about the period of orbits. If you remember what a period is the time it takes for something to complete one cycle. So in this case with circular motion, that means it's the time it takes for the object to complete one complete circle. So let's remember this velocity equation that we derived just a moment ago, and that the linear speed can also be calculated using the orbit and the period. So we know from before that velocity is also 2 pi r, because 2 pi r is the distance around the circle, divided by capital T, which is the time to go around the circle once. So b equals 2 pi r is something that we started talking about earlier in this unit. It's the distance around the circle divided by the total time to travel that distance. And then we spent a few seconds a minute ago deriving this next one over here. So now we're paying attention to the period. So we want to solve this now for t and see what kind of thing we get there. So if we set these two equal to each other and then square them, this is not mathematically correct because we didn't square the b. But anyway, these two are set equal to each other and we're going to square each of them. So basically we get this little guy out from underneath the square root sign, and then all the terms on the other side of the equation are raised to the power of 2. So we have now, instead of 2 pi r over t, we now have 4 pi squared r squared over t squared. Then in the next step, we're going to divide both sides by, we're going to multiply both sides by t squared, and then we're going to multiply both sides by r. So that gets rid of our denominators. And we end up with this expression. And so when we rearrange it for the period, then we find that the square of the period is equal to 4 pi squared over g times m2, all times the radius cubed. This is actually one of Kepler's laws. So we don't really deal with Kepler's laws as much in AP Physics as we used to, but Kepler's laws describe planetary motion in terms of a variety of applications of these kinds of formulas. All right, so if we have a satellite that orbits a planet with a mass of 7 times 10 to the 24 kilograms, and it has a radius of 8.3 times 10 to the 8th meters, then what's the period of its orbit? So we go ahead and just use the formula that we had in the last step, and it's just a calculation that yields this approximately 7 million seconds. This is one where you have to keep track of units carefully to make sure that you're putting everything in standard international units. All right. So this is optional homework. You could do it if you want to. It's not that important. There is a gravitation practice, though, that I gave you that I think is more important perhaps than this. However, if you want to look back at the college physics textbooks on those pages, you certainly can. Thank you, you guys. Appreciate it.